Mizahe. Welcome back, everybody. I hope you enjoyed your lunch break. We're now moving to the second half of day two of the International Water Summit, organized here in partnership, strategic partnership with Abu Dhabi Water and Electricity Authority. I want to thank all our speakers and participants, particularly delegates, for showing such commitment to the themes and topics and the objectives of the Abu Dhabi Sustainability Week. We have two presentations today. We have coffee and then the end of the day, and we resume tomorrow in day three, half day tomorrow. But today we're going to be looking at two countries that are making a huge effort to expand sustainably their water resources, two very contrasting nations. We will hear from Egypt, which of course has got the greatest river in Africa, one of the longest rivers in the world, and historically has been well served with water. How is it dealing with its challenges, water demand challenges, in the years to come? And we'll be hearing from Mr. Atta Honoura from the Public-Private Partnership Central Unit in Egypt, who is leading Egypt's campaign to promote private-public partnerships in all sectors of the economy, including in water, the water supply chain. But first of all, let's look at Oman and Oman's independent water plants and wastewater treatment plants. We have three excellent presenters, and I'll introduce you in a minute. For those of you who don't know Oman well, a few headlines. It's got amongst three key or four key features: a magnificent 1,700-kilometer coastline, majestic mountains, extensive desert, and of course a rather distinct microclimate in the southwest in Dhofar, where it has a monsoon effect, and 4.3 million people, ambitious, youthful, and increasingly well-educated. And it's a country that has a per capita GDP comfortably in the World Bank's middle-income category, so Oman is no longer a poor country. Transformation in the last four decades has been remarkable. It's also established a very robust utilities infrastructure network, providing electricity and water to the overwhelming majority of the population, wherever they may live, including, of course, a very substantial farm population. So we're going to be looking at different aspects of Oman's water program. And to take us through it, we've got three excellent panelists, so I'd like to introduce them. If you'd like to come to the stage, gentlemen. Please. So, Knife, you can sit there. Saeed, maybe on the far left, yes, and then Mahmoud can sit in the middle. We'll sit in the middle. Okay. Right, as you look at the panel, what we have here is Mr. Naif al-Abri. He's the Senior Manager for Water Projects for the Oman Power and Water Procurement Company, which is the single offtake. It plays the role in Oman that ADWEC plays here. It buys the water produced by the IWPs and from the electricity companies as well, and is a critical part in the privatization process. So the OPWP is also responsible, like ADWEC here in Abu Dhabi, for long-term estimations of demand and planning for the whole sector. In the center, very pleased to welcome Engineer Mahmoud Ahmed Al-Amri, Operational Manager in the Al-Wusta Governorate for the Public Authority for Electricity and Water, and he's in the operational side of the desalination, water desalination. So we have policy, government policy, and a speaker, then we have an operational person, and then we dealing with a government-financed water system. And then on your right, I'm very pleased to welcome our third panelist, Mr. Saeed Al-Azmi, who's General Manager for Projects and Higher Water, which is by far the largest water company in Oman, responsible for ensuring the great city of Muscat, the majestic city of Muscat, is properly served with an effective, efficient, reliable sanitary system. And what they're going to be doing is they'll be doing presentations in that order, and then we should have a few minutes at the end for questions. So this is a moment for you to pay attention closely to the presentations that follow. So will you first of all welcome Mr. Naif al-Abri? He'll be followed by Engineer Mahmoud, and finally Mr. Al-Azmi, in that order. So will you please first of all welcome Mr. Naif al-Abri?
alaikum. Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank the sponsors and Reed Exhibition and Edmund for their introduction and their hosting us here. An overview on Oman Power and Water Procurement Company and the water sector and the privatization, which I'll just cover. OPWP role, it was created as part of the restructuring of the whole electricity sector back in 2005, which is a government entity and regulated by AER, which is the Authority of Electricity Regulation. It's, as Edmund has mentioned, it's a single buyer for Oman and forecasted turnover somewhere around the $2 billion for this year. And it's covering the north bit, which is called the main interconnected system, and the southern part of Oman, which is called the Salalah or the Rufar system. The functions and duties of OPWP is basically to secure sufficient production capacity of electricity and related on, and now there's an amendment in the sector law even for unrelated water. And as Edmund has mentioned, our role is to forecast and plan for the country for the requirement of electricity and also cooperating with the various water departments such as the Public Authority of Electricity and Water and the Director General in the South as well for the water demands. So we carry out the whole procurement in a fair, transparent, without any discrimination. Just an overview on the general market structure. As you can see, OPWP being in the center, being shareholded by the electricity holding company. And on the right side, we have AER, which is the regulator. And as mentioned, we carry out the procurement from the generators, that is IWPPs, IPPs, and IWPs. And we have also distribution companies, which are also our clients, which they buy from them in bulk supply tariffs. And we have a transmission company, which is called Oman Electricity Transmission Company, and that's for the electricity side. And our also clients on the water side, which is the water department, represented here by Mahmoud, the Public Authority of Electricity and Water. Further details on the market structure and the payment mechanism, as you can see, there's on this side here, we have the generators, the existing generators, in addition to the future projects that would also join, whereby OPWP pays the generators on a capacity and variable output charge. And furthermore, we have on the other side, which is our clients, which is the distribution companies, as well as the water departments, in which they buy from OPWP based on a cost-reflective bulk supply tariffs. And of course, there's further payments, which is the distribution companies paying the transmission companies as well for connecting to the system. And as you can see at the far corner there, that's where the subsidy, that's where the government provides subsidy to the customers. So throughout here, everything is a cost-reflective, but the subsidy where the government is providing is at the end, which is for the customer itself. Current ownership, as our model is a BOO, build, own, operate, the private OPWP, and represented also by the government, does not hold any ownership in the generators. So they start off, if you look at the bottom, with the our latest projects, they start off with 100% ownership. However, part of the obligation, which we call project founders agreement, they have to sell ownership. It used to be 35, now 40% of ownership, 4 years from the incorporation of the project company. So as you can see, older plants that have already passed through the IPO are owning 65 to 60%, and the public shareholding from 35 now to 40%. Just an overview of the water sector in Oman. We have, it is split into five geographic zones, as you can see here, and these zones are not connected through the transmission network. And probably my colleague Mahmoud will shed more light on this. So we have the main interconnected system that is being Muscat and the northern part of Al-Batna region. We have the Sharqiyah on the east and Musandam up north, Dukum area, and then the far zone just right at the bottom there. So this is how the geographically it is split. The water departments that that are our clients, which is the Public Authority of Water and Electricity, which is governing the north of Oman. The Director General of Water, which is doing the forecasting and the planning, and also our client in the southern part of Oman. And we have Majis Industrial Company, which is really purely focused on Sohar Industrial Port. Just an overview of the current water plants in Oman. Currently, we have somewhere around 750,000 meter cubed by 2015. And these are the six plants that's being either IWPs alone or IWPPs. And majority of the previous ones are IWPPs. However, in the future, we're moving to the reverse osmosis technology, so you will see more of IWPs independently, not being co-located with the power generation. What are the further projects that are under implementation? Currently, somewhere around in a total of 100 MIGD that's coming in the pipeline between 2016-2017. That's being El Gubra, Sur IWP expansion, Barke expansion, and Kuriat IWP expansion. So these are already under construction. The further projects which are under the development, and probably you've heard of Sohar and Barke, which we are now concluding. And these are set for the 2018 commercial operation. And we also released the RFQ for the Sharqiya Salalah IWPs and Dukum IWPs, which are our very recent IWPs that we are tendering in the market. So we have received the SOQs for these as well, the statement of qualification. So we are in the pre-qualification phase for the last three IWPs. And further, there's a note there at the bottom there that Khasab IWP, which is up in the north, Musandam, is something that we will kick in this kickoff this year. And another new MIS, which is in Muscat area for the 2021. So as soon as we finish a project, we are starting another one. So we're already in the phase of carrying out studies on that. Just an overview on what we issue, which is what we call a seven-year statement, which is basically a forecast for what's coming in the next 7 years. And I encourage everyone here to just have a read on this, because it's immediately on the website as soon as it's approved. And we keep updating this seven-year statement every year, so it's not like it's every 7 years. And this is taking into account any changes in the forecast or any new projects that's coming in the pipeline in the country, and even to take into account if there's any delay in the water projects that will be captured. So currently that's available in our website is the 2015-2021 horizon. And we are at the phase of releasing a new one, which is the 2016-2022 by April this year. So I'd be happy to invite everyone to check in our website, which will be available. Just an overview of the demand forecast for the coming 7 years. As you can see, we have high case scenario and base case scenario. This is taken into account the sort of the good or the worst case scenarios. As you can see in Muscat area, somewhere around between the 6% to 8% annual growth rate, which is quite high in a way, and therefore we're trying to really catch up with the increase in growth. And therefore it's already, you can see Sohar, the first two projects are already, we're awarding those two projects and they're coming in the pipeline 2018. And we're also in discussion with regards to extension some existing plants. And right at the bottom, you can see the new IWP, which is planned in 2021, which we are just kicking off to start the whole procurement for it. As I mentioned, these are very separate zones. So another zone, which is the Sharqiya zone for the next seven-year horizon, as was highlighted, the new Sharqiya IWP, which is an 80,000 meter cubed, which was recently the RFQ was released on. And as you can see, somewhere around the 9% peak demand or in that region. Furthermore, in the Dhofar region, which is the south, also another high percentage of growth in there, somewhere around the 8.4%. And that's why we're procuring a new IWP, which is 100,000 meter cubed per day for 2019 operation. Musandam zone is a although it's a smaller growth, however, it's something that we also under procuring for this year for a 16,000 meter cubed IWP. And DOCOM is more or less something that we are in dialogue with the economic authority there. It's something that's more or less really dependent on the investment in that area. But we're building somewhere around the 60,000 meter cubed IWP for operation 2019. Last but not least is Vision 2040. This is in line with the country's vision, whereby OPWP is really working with the various water departments to establish a long-term horizon, which is really a 20-year horizon from 2020 up to 2040 to meet the capacity needs for the forecasted demands. So rather than just the 7 years horizon, we're doing a longer term to be in line with the vision, Oman's vision of 2040. And I'd be happy to invite everyone to check our website. I think there's a lot of information on that, which I have not covered. Thank you very much.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, I want to thank the organizer for this invitation. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa ja'alna min al-ma'a kulla shay'in hayy, afala yu'minun, sadaqallahu al-azim. This is the importance of the water in the world. My contact is including personal, BAW, Al-Wusta, Water Resources, Assets, Future Plan, and Conclusion. My name is Mahmoud Al-Amri. I am Omani. I am a mechanical engineer. I am working in Public Authority for Electricity and Water as an operational manager of Al-Wusta Governorate. Public Authority for Electricity and Water is a government organization and is established in 2007 by the Royal Decree 92/2007. It's provide fresh water to all governorate of Oman except Dhofar Governorate or Salalah. As you see here, the location of Al-Wusta at the south of Oman. It's about 550 kilometers away from Muscat. This is the center of Al-Wusta. The population in Al-Wusta around 41,000 and half people, including expatriate and citizen. Percentage maybe 60% citizen and 40 expatriate in that area. It consists of four wilayat: Mahmoud, Hema, Al-Duqum, and Al-Ghazir. In the past, people was depend in Al-Wusta on the well only for using the water for drinking, cooking, etc. But since the beginning of 1980, desalination plant started to provide water in Al-Wusta region. In Mahmoud Wilayat, we have a desalination plant type of reverse osmosis, which is owned by BAW. We have seven locations, as you see here, the names of these locations. And the value of production of each plant vary from 100 cubic meter per day to 400 cubic meter per day. At the same time, we have also some desalination plant which is owned by private companies. In Mahmoud, we have two of them, one for IDWT, the production of this one, 1,400 cubic meter per day, and Mazun also with the production 400 cubic meter per day. So total of fresh water that produced in Mahmoud around 3,250 cubic meter per day. As you know, this all not sufficient for the old people and Al-Wusta also, especially because the distance is far away from each wilayat to the other. Each wilayat also, there are so many places there. So we have also nine wells which is produced non-drinking water. The conductivity is around from 1,000 to 3,000 microsiemens per centimeter, which used for animals and other external purposes. This is not drinking water. If we're going to Al-Duqum is around 180 kilometers away from Mahmoud. We have, as desalination plant, same in the type of reverse osmosis, which is owned by BAW four locations. The capacity is vary from 150 cubic meter per day to the maximum 400 cubic meter per day. At the same time, also we have some private company, which is Ryko company. This Ryko company, the production of this company is 6,000 cubic meter per day. So the total fresh water produced in Al-Dukhum is around 7,100 cubic meter per day. The consumption right now, we have 3,500 cubic meter per day. In Dukhum also, we are providing for the duck also. And also we have investment there. So we only provide water and hotels. We have three hotels there. We are only the supplier for this water. We have also five wells, which is the production of these also from one, the conductivity of these wells from 1,000 to 3,000 microsiemens per centimeter. And this is only for animals and other external purposes also. If we go directly also to the Salalah side, we'll find Wilayat Al-Jazr. Al-Jazr is around 180 kilometers away from Al-Dukhum. We have also three plants there, which is owned by BAW. The production of these plants vary from 100 to 600 cubic meter per day. At the same time, we have also desalination plant, which is type of reverse osmosis. This owned by Ryko also. Production of these 250 cubic meter per day. So at the end, the total fresh water produced in Al-Ghazar is around 1,200 cubic meter per day. In Al-Ghazar, we have also same as other wilayats, we have some wells. These wells, the conductivity of them from 1,000 to 3,000 microsiemens per centimeter, which is used for animals only and other external purposes. At the same time, in Al-Ghazar, we have one well, and this is the well, the only well in Al-Wusta, full whole Al-Wusta, which is drinking water. The conductivity is less than 500 microsiemens per centimeter. If we go to the center of, it is the center from the government, but it's not the location in the center, it's Hema. Hema is from Muscat, 550 kilometer, and it is from the Dukhum, 180 kilometer, and Al-Ghazar, 240 kilometer maybe. So Hema is not coastal area. So we use only brackish water in this desalination plant. The only wilayat which is used brackish water as a feed for this reverse osmosis plant. We have two plants which is owned by BAW, Hema and Al-Khumkham. Hema production 500 cubic meter per day, Al-Khumkham 100 cubic meter per day. We have also one RO destination plant which is owned by Ryko. The production of this one is 200 cubic meter per day. So the total fresh water which is produced in Hema is 800 cubic meter per day. In Hema, we have also some wells which is conductivity is high from 1,000 to 3,000 microsiemens per centimeter. And this only using for animal and some external purposes. At the end, so that these wells, we are not charging the water. We are only operate and maintenance these wells and provide water free for people. We have, as BAW, the following assets in Al-Wusta. We have destination plants, around 16 location of RO destination plant. We have also water networks. This network is only for three wilayat out of four wilayat, for Mahout, Dukhum, and Al-Ghazar. Hema, we don't have right now network due to the less production regarding to the consumption. We have also 23 wells in Al-Wusta. We have recently two future plants for Al-Wusta, one in Al-Dukhum. The capacity of this plant is around 12,000 cubic meter per day. The production right now is 6,000 cubic meter per day, as mentioned before. We have now extension for 2,000 and the work in progress. So this will be completed in July 2016. So the production of this plant will be 8,000 cubic meter per day at the end of July 2016. Haima, as I told before, is away from the sea, so we only depending on the brackish water for the desalination plant as a feed water. So now we have one project also to make transmission water line, which is DI 400 mm. This distance is around 175 kilometers from Ad-Dukhum. This will be water provided from Ad-Dukhum through pumping station to Haima. We have in this project also some pumping stations for two locations during this line, with reservoirs also, and some networks also in this project. This project should be established in February 2016 and will be staged till 3 years. BAW vision to 2040 to achieve 98% in connection in all Oman. At the conclusion, recently we have total production of fresh water in full Al-Wusta, 12,350 cubic meter per day. Water network we have, as I mentioned before, only for Mahmoud, Dukhum, and Al-Jazer. So only Hemay they don't have. After 3 years will be the network is there due to the shortage of water only, not other issue. We have also total 28 wells at this or Ulayat. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope I still can keep you awake. It's difficult after lunch. Thanks for my colleague for the presentations, and thanks, Edmond, for your introduction. I got a couple of slides trying to summarize them. They are quite a lot, but let's see how can we progress of this. I'm covering the following topics, but I'm going to be brief and specific and to the point. The time doesn't allow me to cover in details. However, I will try at the same time to deliver the message. Yeah, some of the point I will cover is the focusing on wastewater treatment plant, overview of the use of the treated water in the country, and opportunity within the country. Now, Oman, like many other countries in GCC, there's a high commitment from the leader himself, His Majesty, on the water management, and specifically on the wastewater. And he has said this long time back, and there's a lot of investment has been put by the government to develop wastewater infrastructure, and very much supported, totally mentioned by the government itself. High Water is basically is a wastewater company, and it has been established in 2002. It is a government company, 100%. We have a concession of 30 years to develop, manage, and operate wastewater of domestic in the country itself. Then we signed agreement for Muscat Municipality, who are the in the capital of Muscat, who they are taking all the treated effluent as much as they can, although we have savers at the moment. We also got a land acquisition which we can use for our purpose, about 21 plots available for use for higher water projects. I don't go much in geography, but basically, the map shows where Oman sits. We are share border on the west with Saudi Arabia, and the north east is our colleague Emirates, and the north is Iran, and it is open all the way to south to Australia, Africa. You mentioned it. Yeah. The country itself, in terms of specifically on wastewater, is split into 11 governorates, yeah, and I will specifically today touch on the green part, which is the Muscat governorate, where the concession agreement, which we have at the moment. I will also touch areas in other 10 governorates where higher water has also been granted by the government to manage the wastewater instead of regional municipality in this area. apart from the pink color at the bottom south, they have another independent company who is managing the wastewater. Basically, as I mentioned, our services is to collect wastewater domestically by network. And in some areas where we are still developing, these are coming through tankers. And that is goes into the processing plants and where we get two products, basically. The sludge, which we process for agriculture, which you can see at the bottom, that's a compost plant. And then the treated effluent, it goes to irrigation, where we sell to other government sectors. Of course, the compost, the fertilizers also feeding to our areas of greenery of the country itself. Treated effluent, the gentleman today, Edward, he mentioned a lot about it. And here we are also, we are facing more or less same problems. But Oman is one of those countries, we have an issue with the water, surface water is there. And we are using already this treated effluent or treated water for public parks. Also using for the Gulf Coast, we are getting for these treated effluents. We also use it for dust control as well. In the future, we already engage with the University of Sultan Qaboos in Oman. We are already studying the recharge of this water into aquifer, although at the moment it's not feasible for many reasons. But also, Oman is well known in the mountains, so a lot of rainwater as well there is held up beyond the dams. But again, we right now we are talking to Ministry of Agriculture, where they can use for agriculture itself. We've got about 5 farms in the Muscat area to try of using treated effluent for agriculture. We also use them for the industrial cooling. Already in some areas we start using this treated effluent water. We are using also for construction, mainly on the structure testing, hydro test of the concrete structures that thus used also being put in place. Also what I mentioned here, we in the government of Muscat no longer allowed to use potable water for greenery, except only few places, but most of use the treated effluent. That's the policy in the country. This is a very heavy slice. I'm not expecting to start all of that, but basically the yellowish bars, these are production of the treated effluents. And then the caves, the blue one, is a high demanding season. Then the one in green in the middle of the curve is the mid-season, and the lower yellowish curve is the lower demanding season. Exactly what you mentioned this morning by Edward this morning, where they mentioned that some of the treated effluent is get thrown into the water, into the sea. Is unfortunately the same is happening at the moment with us. Although we're using a lot of it, but still we need to put more infrastructure and put more network to use all the treated effluent. And you can see the forecast there until 2025, we will maybe still dispose about 20% of treated effluent into the sea. We are working with other government sectors to try and utilize maximum of treated effluent to minimize the cost of the energy and using the potable water, which my colleague already have covered earlier. But we are seeing a growth of demand of using of the treated effluent. The black line at the bottom there, you see going flat until 2018. This is a 1 million palm project. We have a project to plant 1 million dead trees, and that plan to start in 2018, where the water also will be consumed to irrigate this massive project in the country. This map, it doesn't mean a lot to you guys, but basically, this is the map of Governorate of Muscat. This is about 35 square kilometers. And the dot line, what you're seeing there, this is our treated effluent network. So all of the government of the Governorate of Muscat has been covered with the network for treated effluent. Whoever visits Muscat, you will see a lot of greenery. These have been irrigated by using treated effluent. The areas you see nothing there is actual mountains. There's a lot of mountains we have in the country. This is our vision, but basically what you see there, we would hope by 2020 to connect about 80% of the household properties in the country. That's a very challenging target. We are working towards it. At the moment, we connect about 30 to 40% of the properties. The challenge we are facing is the population growth. For the last maybe 10 years, our population forecast was about 2 to 3% growth. And suddenly, about 2 years ago, the population grew by 18%. So basically, 10 years ago, the population in Muscat, it should have been only 0.7, 0.8 million. Today, we are 1.3 million population in Muscat, so almost doubled. And this is really like a moving target. Maybe it's good for the country, but again, it's very, very difficult to meet the challenging to try to capture the target. However, still we're aiming to go that way. You can see the blue line, that's the where probability of connecting to achieve 2020, 80% treated sewage connections in the government of Muscat. What are priorities? Basically, personally, I would have loved to see Oman or Muscat is like Singapore or Perth, the gentleman mentioned this morning, where all greenery and water are the features in the government of Muscat in Oman in total, and to provide a better, healthy, greener place. And that's what we're aiming to do. Again, as I mentioned, our target to achieve 80% connections, we have to do that. We need to avoid throwing our treat influent into the sea, and that's again, it's been accepted and going ahead with that one. And I'm seeing actually there's a time will come, we will have not enough treat influent to get all the areas we wish to do so. Most of the question coming to all of most of the contractors and the consultant, what our contract strategy? Of course, this depends on the market, depends on the project to project. It depends on the situation you have on specific project and specific locations. But basically, we have design, build, and operate. We have that option as well. We have EPC. Yeah, that's also, we have exercised that as well. We have also remeasurable. We have BOQs, and then those are being measured as we're proceeding with the work itself. We also recently, we have developed what they call call of contract, where we actually trying to get this contract in place to look at the design or supervision construction as we're proceeding. Yeah, what we are, the best approach to the project, personally I think the best one we're seeing is design and build. That's especially for the STPs. For network is BOQ, the best one based on the population, based on the nature of the country, what we have. This is what we saw earlier, the map of the Muscat. But basically, if you're interested only, the biggest bluish-green color, that's a project about 100 million rial Omani to be tendered starting next year. And the one in brownish or oranges is one area has already floated this week. When we took over the government of Muscat, we had 600 kilometers of sewage lines. Today, we have 4,000 kilometers of a sewage line in the capital, Muscat. And that will grow to 6,000 kilometers for the coming years. This is a typical area called Amrat, which is the government of Muscat. Based on what you see, sometimes what we do, we pick up a particular location or area, we develop completely. So what you see, there are about four projects in different colors. They're network for sewage and treated effluents. And the red line in the middle, that's the main collector, and then the blue color, the bottom there in the middle, that our STP plant. These are already over 110 million rial Oman in terms of expenditure, and they are in different phases of construction. The work is ongoing right now as we're speaking. This is one of the biggest area we have in SIB. SIB is one part of the Muscat, of course. We completed a lot of this project. However, I don't know if you can see from there, but the C8, the purple, dark purple, the C9, and also the yellowish at the bottom, these are all of them still pending to be floated in the coming time. This just give indication, these names are a wilayat of Muscat, yeah, the governor of Muscat, of the 1.4 million population, 1.3, and these are different locations. And our budget for the remaining project to come is 1.1 billion rial Omani scattered in different areas. This is excluding the one already completed. This is the one to be executed as we're speaking from now until 2022. I'm not going to go through this, but basically what it shows here, ladies and gentlemen, different type of projects and expected times to start and expected time to complete. Of course, this is the plan. But again, the 1.1, what you saw earlier, are this detail of this, all of these projects. Yeah, this is another area which is in the Boshi area. We already, ongoing project today is about 800 million real omanis. And these about 90% have been completed. These projects are committed. Some of them already been commissioned. That's 815 real oman project in the governorate of Muscat. This one of the plants we commissioned recently is 60,000 cubic meter per day. It is, I'm not going to go through the process, but basically for those familiar, is SBR, sequential batch reactor. And we got sea outfall to go with it. Some of the photographs, this plant is about 14 meters down the ground. These particular pumps we're seeing there, they're actually 14, 15 meters down of the above ground level, pumping the sewage, which is received by gravity, by the way. Also a system, either vacuum system or gravity. I would say 80% is gravity, and a very minority of our project are driven by a vacuum system. This particular one is a gravity network. Yeah, this is another location, the OCU, auto control unit, or the same plant. And these auto filtrations was associated with the plant to ensure the quality of water received is very, very high quality. Those are the decanter, when the water once treated will be scooped up to storage areas for export. We also have a sea outfall. Unfortunately, we do have sea outfall for mainly three reasons. One of them, should we have a storm and this disaster, then all the sewage you get pumped into the sea to almost about 2 or 3 kilometers away, all been studied environmentally. Also, sometimes, should we have non-spec treated effluent, we cannot be consumed or cannot be taken by the agriculture people, we also put into the sea. And sometimes we have extra treated effluent also put into the sea as well. So that's also a project being associated with that particular project in the CBR specific. This is another plant working on. This is MBR technology. This photo about 3 months old, and the plant slightly in advance now. And when we finish, you have something like this, where we also, what we do as part of our social development social responsibilities, we are creating playgrounds and tennis courts to allow the people, the local, to enjoy it. The big tanks you see there, the round ones, are for treated effluent, where we store the water in case of lower demand, then get pushed into the system at high demand situation. This plant, 80% completed. We hope it to commission end of this year, early next year, hopefully. The plant, this we saw earlier, the SBR is completely all covered. This is already in operation. We are working phase two right now for this particular plant. This plant under evaluation right now is in the area called Misfa. We are evaluating the bids right now. This is, we're going to be receiving the yellow tankers where the sewage network is not ready yet, and the plant was hopefully to award by next month. This is another view of the same plant we have seen earlier. Outside Muscat, as I mentioned, the Ministry Council have given the green light to Highwater to start operating the sewage system outside Muscat. And already in November last year, we've started operating, maintaining the sewer system outside Muscat. The project yet to be transferred to Haya, and that will happen in due course, just to finalize the agreement right now as we're speaking. Yeah, I mentioned already about how we are distributed our sewage network, but basically the bottom line here, Haya will cover the entire country, apart from South Oman, where another company is dealing with that one. So we've got a level of challenge ahead of us to look at it. At the moment, what we're doing, ladies and gentlemen, we are studying the facilities which will be taken over from the government. We're doing asset management inspection to determine the capacity, the integrity, so that we can plan ahead what we need to be done outside Muscat. That's what the stage where we are right now. This what expectations in terms of budget, in terms of the sewage outside Muscat. This is slide very fresh, is very much estimated. We are still under study period, and we're hoping to start doing this project by 2018 and move up And you can see the budget there. It is about 2 billion, 2.1 billion real Omani to cover until 2035. And we're aiming to achieve 80% connectivity in the country, a population of 4.5 million, which were scattered in different areas. We already have some projects. This may be, it mean nothing to you as much. The first two projects, the first one is ongoing. The other three is in tendering stage right now. They are network and STPs at different sizes. This project, although also Muscat, but the government have asked Highwater to manage them because of the criticality and urgency to proceed with these particular four projects. This is my last slide. This is the wetland in the Muscat area. Should you visit Muscat, you're welcome to visit us. And for your information only, we are attracting about 200 species of birds in this particular wetland in the governorate of Muscat. And this year we achieved about a visitor's watch bird, about 2,000 people who came visit us. With that, I'm concluding my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Asazmi, for a wonderful update. Only three or four minutes. If you want to send a question anonymously, you use your iPad, press the question here, and you send a question, and I believe it will come to me. Alternatively, you throw your hand up and ask the question in the normal manner. Right, any questions? Quick ones from me. First of all, to Knife, the effect that the tariff increases, the price increases, or planned reduction of the subsidies, where are we? Where are we going to go? The water.
Okay. When you're saying tariff increases?
Well, the price of water. I mean, there's a subsidy coming in. What's the position? What's the position the government is taking?
I mean, as you know, the oil subsidy has been lifted in Oman a few days ago.
Nothing on water.
But there is no talk on water yet. But I cannot assure that it will never come.
Okay.
There is a lot of direction in that aspect. But I personally believe that if we go through that path, I think it has to be categorized rather than just a lump sum to everyone.
And on the question of the technology, you're in procurement. When you're looking ahead, are you still planning to procure thermal desalination capacity? Or have you, I mean, Abu Dhabi is making a very big strategic decision to actually, well, not completely phase out, but procure the majority of its future needs using from membrane technology. What's the position as far as Oman is concerned?
Our policy so far is now we're delinking power and water, hence we're going with RO.
So you're separating the... Do you think you will ever procure a cogeneration plant ever again, a new one?
Even if it's together, but it's probably not going to be MSF nor Amiti. We're still, even if it's in the same site, it's going to be RO plus power. So we're not linking thermal. We're not going for thermal.
Okay, so that's a strategic choice, and that's advised everybody here. Mahmoud, operational challenges for your reverse osmosis plants on the coast. How difficult has it been operating comparatively sophisticated technology in remote locations on the coast in your area? How difficult has it been? Have you had major operational challenges? Fouling or matter?
And yes, we are using all RO membranes, the destination of RO membranes. We are facing fouling and we are facing scaling as well. This is the most important, critical things we
and
are
how
meeting.
Are you dealing with those challenges?
But now... Mm-hmm.
How are you dealing with those challenges on fouling and
I mean, steering? This is we are concentrating on the pre-treatment. If we are doing the pre-treatment as well, that means we are cutting this fouling and scaling. And especially for the fouling, for example, we are not taking open intake. We have wells, which is beach wells. So this is as a pre-filtration for that. So the fouling is not too much we have there. For the scaling, as I mentioned, we are using type of chemicals, which is, getting rid of this. But the most challenge we are facing, the delivery of the items. For example, if we need membranes, the lifetime of membranes is 4 years, for example. If you are operate very well, that means that you increase the lifetime of the membranes.
If you want to order, maybe it will take 2 months to 3 months to reach.
Yeah.
Member. So this is the, I mean, we have challenge in this equipment delivery.
Good. Well, if anybody's got suggestions to operating in comparatively small RO plants in pretty remote locations down near Dukum, please share them with Mahmoud. And finally, Mr. Al-Mazmi, who has just told us that Higher Water, which is created to provide water services to the Muscat Governorate, is now being mandated to extend its remit across the whole of the country. It's going to be a national sanitation and sewage treatment plant business, with the exception of Muscat. So that's a huge change in terms of the way you see technology developing in your sewage treatment plant. You're using very advanced technology, some submerged membrane unit, one of the largest. How do you think you see the technology changing as far as your company's concerned, particularly to do with sustainability? What do you think are the main technical innovations that you will be pursuing?
Yeah, it's, absolutely. It's, the fact that now we're going out of Muscat, the technology very much depends on the many factors. One of the issues what we have right now is actually the space, the plot areas, which driving that to choose which technology you need to choose. Now, the fact that we are moving towards also Muscat with the availability of the land, then we will be going to things like CAS, conversion activation sludge. We can go things like the reed beds. We can also adopt things like MBBR as well. However, the company very much open to all technology,
right,
based on the cost effectiveness of life cycle, what we need to achieve. We have all MBBR, we have MBR, we have SBR. We are trying reed beds right now, speaking. So we are very much open to different technology, what's happening. What we're trying to do, Edmund, that we're trying to negotiate with the government on the quality of water. With the quality of water which we are treating is very, very high quality, which costs a lot of money, and maybe is not needed us to achieve such quality. And we are negotiating our concession agreement should that be reduced, will be cost-effective at the same time, we're not harming the environment. That's something that's ongoing right now as we're speaking.
Very good.
Yeah.
Of course, and that will become more relevant as your plans become more extensive. Does anybody have any questions? One question, yes, please. Microphone, or can you boom it out? Can you shout it? Well, well, we got one, but...
Thank you very much. Once again, it's a great pleasure for me to be in Abu Dhabi and to be with all of you. So my question to all of the speakers, from which countries Sultanate Oman is importing fresh water currently, and what are your expectations regarding the shares of fresh drinking water and desalinated water in the market of water in your country for coming 2-3 years? Thank you very much.
Sorry, you're saying, where does Oman get its...
Sorry?
What kind of water?
The question is regarded with fresh drinking water and desalinated water.
Oh, it's, well, it's all made in...
Yeah.
It's all made in Oman.
It's all the country.
I mean...
And spring water as well,
a bit of
that.
Well, maybe the best guy to answer this would be Naib, but basically we have almost like, I would say, 2 or 3 different type of source of water. One is... fresh water, groundwater, and the destination waters there as well, those as well. And then, of course, the dams, which is also source of the groundwater where the springs comes up. I don't know if you're familiar with something called fellage, but this is a stream of natural water which found in the whole country in different wilayat, where there's a natural flow of this source of water which been there for thousands of years. But however, that's slightly reduced from place to place, and that been placed by presentation from Mahmoud and the Naif, where desalination water is coming in RO plant in different area in the desert is also been done. Also, on top of that, I need to add something which is maybe not clear. We, Oman being the mountainous area or geographical or terrain, it actually helped us a lot in a sense that we are capturing a lot of water in the dams, and this gets recharged into the groundwater and get reused later on. So that's also there as well.
One question from the floor, and this is the last one. What is HIAT doing to attract more international consultants? Do you want some more international consultants?
Yeah, I would definitely, I'm sure my colleague also would touch base on this. But for your information, only one of the difficult which we maybe had actually finding more players in the wastewater, whether they're consultant or contractors. So I would like to send this invitation to all of you who really in the wastewater services, whether consultant or contractors, we do have a scope, and there's no plan to reduce our projects due to the price of oil at the moment. And we need or whoever is need to participate, whether as a consultant or a contractor. There's still a business there is lie ahead of us.
Thanks very much indeed. Well, that's the end of this session, I'm afraid. But as you've heard, Oman is a country with great ambition, determined to continue investing in its infrastructure, has got a very substantial budget for expanding its desalination using new technology, as well as extending its sanitation system and upgrading it so we're aiming for 80% connections, creating opportunities for everyone in this room. Will you show your appreciation, please, to our panelists?